You've seen me spritz and spray our new stencils, but today we're following a slightly different path where we'll use paste and gels along with Inca Gold, glitter, and all kinds of fun things. If you think of these stencils as design tools, you realize just how infinite the possibilities are. And that's our goal today, exploring the limitless possibilities of working with our Joggle stencils. We're going to begin with the technique that I probably enjoy the most, and that's working with modeling paste and stencils. Here are some examples of that, and one of the things that I really like is the fact that unlike dabbing paint or spritzing through a stencil that provides design but a totally flat surface, the modeling paste gives you a raised effect. And if you don't scrape smoothly across the top of your stencil when you're applying the modeling paste, you get variances in the height, and you sometimes get little peaks and valleys in the modeling paste, and I really like that. And the nice thing is that the paste will hold all of its dimension as it dries. Let me show you how I do this. I have a piece of chipboard, and it's already been primed with gesso, and it's on both sides and the edges. These are going to be book covers, and I'm going to punch holes in them and bind them with binding rings, and so I want to be certain that everything visible eventually will be covered with paint or something. Gesso is all set to go and it's dry, and I'm doing that because the chipboard is that, you know, that kind of brownish gray color, and I don't want to see that. I want to start with a white surface. Now when you choose a stencil, you have a lot of different options. You can use an all-over pattern like this one is, lay it on and wipe the modeling paste through here, you know, with your palette knife or your old credit card. You can, and mine are hooked together. You can isolate a certain element on the design, and what I've done is taped around it with release tape, I think this is frog tape, so that if I were to lay this on here and apply the modeling paste, I can pick this up and move it, but each time I'm going to be limited to this single element, and I like doing that. I think that this would have worked, but it's a little bit more structured, and I like the sort of all-over loosey-goosey look you get when you just pick an element and put it in various places. The other option that you can do is work with a design like this one that actually fits very nicely on the whole cover here. Now I might lose a little bit of the stems on the bottom and a little bit of the tulip on the top, or the pointy edge of the flower there on the top, but I don't really care about that because I think that this is going to look really cool. However, before you put your design on there with modeling paste, and this is something that I stumbled on quite by accident. And these things happen, and it's just great when they do. I was thinking A, and I tried to do A, and what I ended up with was B, and I like it far better. So I'm real happy that was one of those serendipitous kind of accidents. I'm going to start with a very light misting of a couple of colors of, it's dilutions, it's color wash, it's whatever it is. And when I say really light, I mean really light, because I've tried this with applying more colors, and I find that I like this lighter look far better. It's more delicate when the piece is finished. So what I'm going to do is just pick this up, I'm going to wipe up the mist so that I'm not working in it, and then I'm going to come in with my handy dandy heat gun and dry this, and then we'll talk about applying the modeling paste. My sprays are all dry, and so now it's time to come in and place the stencil and then apply the modeling paste through it. And I am going to go for that look where the stems run off the bottom a little bit, and the top of this, the pointy part of this petal, is actually going to run off as well. And then I'm just going to center the design more or less from side to side, and I'm not going to bother to tape this down. It's not going to be on here that long, and I'm going to be pretty careful to hold it down. So I'm going to start applying the modeling paste. And one of the things that you might notice as I go along and do this is that it's picking up that little bit of color from the sprays, and some of that color, again, because the dilutions and the color wash are not going to be permanent on this surface, it's going to pick them up a little bit, and it will color the modeling paste a little bit. And that actually just works fine. It will go along with the whole process, which you will see me do in just a second once we get this modeling paste on here. One of the reasons I'm using the light modeling paste is because, again, this is one of those quite by accident things, I found that it cleans up really easily off of the stencil. All I have to do is put it in the sink and turn the sprayer on so that I'm getting a mist spray, or that, you know, that sort of opposite of the just single stream spray. And I find that, and this is Liquitex light modeling paste, I find that it cleans up really easily that way. I don't have to spend a lot of time trying to scrub the modeling paste off. Now, one thing that you should bear in mind is that though I'm going to put this to one side and not do anything with it for a few minutes, I am going to clean it immediately after I get through shooting this segment because I don't want the goop to dry on the stencil. So I'm going to pick this up. I'm going to put it to one side for the moment. Let's find a safe place to put that. And you can see now that my design is on this piece of chipboard. You can also see that I've got some elements that it might be a little bit high, so I'm just going to come in here with my finger and lightly touch it over, and really nobody will know that that's not how it was intended to look. You can also see that I've got spots that are kind of running off the chipboard, and all I do is come in with my finger and wipe downward that way, and that way it takes the excess off without actually disturbing the design that's on the front of the piece. Now this has got to dry before you can do anything with it, but because I've got something prepped, let me just clean the molding paste up off of my craft sheet, and then let me bring a couple in here that I have prepped. I did these a little bit earlier, and I'm a little concerned about this one. I think I might have put too much color on here, but I'm going to show you what happens next when we take the step of adding the Liquitex iridescent medium. Again, all I was doing with this was playing, and it just struck me as so pretty, and I got really excited about the technique, and that's why I wanted to share it. So I'm going to begin with this one, and this is our flower blossom stencil. Let me grab the iridescent medium. This is the Liquitex iridescent medium. All I'm going to do is grab a brush. Now again, a moment ago I mentioned the fact that these colors are not permanent, even though they're on this gessoed surface. If I take the iridescent medium and I do this, I'm absolutely going to pick the color up and move it. And no matter how careful I am, there is going to be some movement, but I want to avoid any more movement than is necessary. So I'm going to come in and brush this iridescent medium over the entire surface. And you can see that it's already started to pick the color up and move it. But again, I'm being careful to do this with as few brush strokes as possible so that I leave the colors kind of where they are without spreading them around too much. And so that actually means probably using a little bit heavier coat of the iridescent medium because I don't want to spend a lot of time brushing it around. Now what I can do is dab it up and down in the areas around the various sections of the molding paste that form the design of the stencil. And then when I come back out to areas where there isn't so much molding paste, I can start to brush. Now, there is a certain inevitability to this. You are going to get movement of your color, and so you do want to think about that. I like when the brush strokes are all moving in the same direction, and so I'm being careful to stroke continually in the same direction so that I don't get movement in the opposite direction or even on the diagonal. Again, I'm going to come in here and very lightly brush. And you can see that the medium in the brush is starting to get colored too. And that's part of the process. It can't be helped. It's just the way this technique works. However, I'm okay with that. But this is the reason that I cautioned you to use only a little bit. Because if you use too much, and when I say a little bit, I mean of the sprays, whatever you use to color the surface with. If you use too much, I find that there's way too much color moving around here, and it loses that kind of delicate, ethereal look. Now, I need to just come in and make certain that I've got this iridescent medium everywhere. And then I'm going to lightly brush here, and I want to make certain that there's nothing that's kind of gooped up where it's run into the dried molding paste. Again, I'm doing my thing with the brush strokes so that I get some uniformity. If you want variance, then by all means, change the way you stroke on this. And the final thing I do is to just come back and lightly stroke over here so that I know that I've got a smooth result. Now, eventually, the back of this will be finished the same way, although I won't put molding paste on it. I'll just spritz some color on it, dry it, and then I'll apply a coat of the iridescent medium. So this is what you end up with when you work with light colors like this. Let me put this to one side and let me clean off my brush because obviously the iridescent medium has certainly picked up some color. And let me just wipe up the excess here. And let's bring this one in. I'm going to do the same thing, because really this is the magic part. This is where all the really fun stuff happens. Now again, I used more color here, so you can already see the iridescent medium picking up the color. So what I think I'm going to do is initially get my brush working over the larger areas of the modeling paste and make certain that I have coverage on all of those areas. And if I want to bring some color in, I can do this and bring it in and stroke it through like that. If you don't, and you want to leave your color mostly confined to the background, then obviously you need to be a little bit more careful how you stroke the iridescent medium across the piece. But I really think that this is very magical. I love the way the colors move, and what looks one way when you begin looks very different by the time you get through. Now, if you find that there's too much color coming up, clean all of that out of your brush, dip it back into the iridescent medium so that when you're starting to apply again, you're applying clean medium that doesn't have any color on it. Again, I'm just going to brush through and make certain that all my areas are covered. Now, I think that this makes great journal covers, or excuse me, it makes great book covers, but this technique would also work really well on a journal page if you wanted to do that. There's lots of different ways that you can utilize this technique, and I know that on journal pages is something that I definitely will do, because of course the iridescent medium gives a certain amount of glimmer, and we all know that I like glimmer. This is just the barest beginnings of what we can do with the stencils, and we're going to look at some other things in just a moment. Let's talk now about using Inca Gold with our stencils. Most of you have either seen me work with this or worked with it yourself. It's a wonderful product. It comes in this paste form, and you can either pick it up with your finger to work with it, or you can use a piece of cut and dry foam, and that's what I'm going to do right now. The colors are wonderfully deep and shimmery, and this is just a really fun product. Here's our flower patch stencil, and all I'm going to do is just show you how this works on this tag. Grab your cut and dry foam, rub it over the surface of the Inca Gold till you get some of it loaded onto the foam, and then you just go ahead and kind of dab and rub it through the openings on the stencil. This is really, really straightforward, really, really easy to do. Now, under ideal circumstances, I would have this tag probably adhered to the surface with a piece of tape on the back or something. I'm just, for the purposes of demonstration, I didn't bother to do that this time. But so that my stencil wouldn't move, and so that the piece underneath wouldn't move if I was working with something smaller than, let's say, a journal page, I probably would adhere them both down. I'd get that tag stuck to the table, and then I'd tape the border of the stencil so that it wouldn't move. All right, well, you can see how this goes and how this works. Lift it up and you obviously get the design of the stencil, which is fantastic. Let me just close this up. Now, you're not limited to tags or journal pages, of course. These are one of the sizes and styles of the Meyer Rhode envelope, and you've seen me use these before in various sort of incarnations. All I did was lay our branches stencil on here. I flipped the flat back, and I laid the stencil on and did what you just saw me do. Now, once the Inca Gold has had a moment to dry, you come in with a piece of clean paper towel, and you go ahead and you buff it, and it really brings the shine up on the Inca Gold. You have to make certain that it's dry, because if you don't, even though you see some pink on this paper towel, it's not moving any place on here. It's just picking up a little bit of pink as I rub the paper towel over it. But if this Inca Gold wasn't dry, it would, you know, it might smear a little bit if I had a section where I put it on kind of thickly. So that's how that works. Now, you're of course not limited to tags and envelopes. This works really well on journal pages too. This is our flower blossom design, and what I've done is isolated this section off. In fact, this is from earlier. I haven't used it yet. And what I'm going to do is use some Inca Gold, and this is one of the blues. I don't remember which one it is. A clean piece of cut and dry foam, and I'm going to get some of that on here. And now I have the option of sort of putting this design anywhere on this journal page that I want. Now, if I'd wanted real strong contrast, I could have used a color that more strongly contrasted with the background. But there are areas on this page, or this page spread rather, that are different colors than what I'm working on here. And so I will get more of that contrast depending on where else I go ahead and I lay the stencil down and I apply the ink gold. Stencils are really versatile. They're one of the reasons that I really wanted to bring in a product line, and I wanted them to be stencils because they just lend themselves to so many things. Okay, and there is my design. Again, you can see it a little bit more here and here where the contrast is stronger, but as I bring it across the rest of the page, I'll get lots of contrast, especially like over here, because there's such a strong contrast between the color of the ink gold and the background of this page. This is just the barest beginnings. We're going to look at some more fun things in just a moment. Earlier we talked about gel medium in as much as I said that it could be applied through the stencil in the same way that we did with the light molding paste to get kind of a dimensional effect. But of course gel medium makes a great adhesive too, and let me show you a way to use it with one of the stencils and of course some glitter. I have some Liquitex just matte gel medium that I'm going to put out on my craft sheet. And I have another piece of cut and dry foam. My glitter is here, and I'm going to work on one of the Maya Rote envelopes. I have our Flourish stencil, and I think I'm going to put it on the body of the envelope. I might come back and put it on the flap too, but for now I'm going to work on the body. So what I'm going to do is take the string, and I'm going to tuck it underneath that little circle of craft paper. I'm going to lay the stencil on here, and I'm going to be reasonably careful to keep the design from coming up underneath the flap. I want it to really just end at the top of the envelope. And again, I probably should be taping this, but all things being equal, I'm not. Now, when I apply this, I want to dab this through the opening, because if I rub, I'm liable to get gel medium where I don't want it. So what I'm going to do is just get some gel medium on the cut and dry foam and tap it like this to get it loaded, if you will. And then I'm going to tap through the opening. Now I know where my stencil is lined up. I'm sort of at the edge of my envelope, so I don't have to worry about the design scooting beyond up onto the inside of that flap. You do need to work reasonably quickly because you don't want the gel medium to dry before you can get the glitter adhered to it. Now this will work with glitter. This will work with something like Perfect Pearls, and it will certainly work with any other kind of powdered medium, for example, Pearl-X or things along those lines. And it really is just a question of applying the gel medium through the stencil and then once I get this done, I'll apply the glitter. Just coming back to refresh this, what I did initially, I don't want it to start to dry on me. Now again, I don't want the gel medium to dry on here, so as soon as I get through filming this segment, I'm going to take the stencil to the sink and rinse this right off. But for now, let me put that to one side. Bring in a piece of scratch paper. Now there's gel medium all over this nonstick craft sheet, so I'm going to end up with glitter stuck to it if I don't bring in this scratch paper. Plus it'll help me collect the excess glitter. And I'm using some black here. I'm going to tap it all around and get it thoroughly covered. And I'll give it a good flick to knock off all the excess. And I'll put this to one side so I can scoop that back in the container after. And how cool is this? This is the pattern of the stencil. Again, this one is Flourish. And I did miss in a couple places because I'm, you know, rushing trying to get this done so that you can see it. But think of all the cool things you can do with Pearl-X and Perfect Pearls, glitter of all kinds, even flocking or those kinds of things. You can create kind of dimensional textured embellishments on cards, certainly on things like these envelopes, tags, journal pages. The sky really is the limit. We've been playing with all kinds of fun products today, but I don't want to lose sight of one of the more obvious ones, which is to work with paint and stencils. And one of the nice things about using a dabber top bottle like this is that your applicator is built in. It's really very straightforward. You just want to tap onto your nonstick craft sheet to make certain that the paint is flowing. And you want this to flow out rather slowly. You don't want a lot of paint to come out at once. I find that I get better results if I use a bolder design like this and if I apply the paint in small amounts at a time and making certain that I fill the openings on the stencils really well. Otherwise, I get a design that looks kind of choppy. Again, I can come back over to the side and push and squeeze the bottle to make certain that the paint is flowing, and then come in and start tapping. And if I wanted to blend colors of paint, if I wanted to use another dabber, I could certainly do that as well, and then just, you know, if there's any mixing of the color on the dabber top, just clean it off with a wet paper towel after the fact. And when you get through, I missed over here. Let's clean this up. When you get through, you get a nice version of the design. And I like this with the tribal look. It's kind of got that distressed, not all there effect, because you get a little bit of paint that creeps under the stencil. And of course, I'm just showing you on a tag, but there's lots of other things that you can do as well when you're working with this. This is another of the Maya Road envelopes, and this is a landscape oriented one. So what I'm going to do is take our Three Totems stencil, just kind of align it in here, and this time I'm going to use, this is Pearl. I'm going to use this again. I'm going to come off to the side. You can't see me, sorry. I'm going to come off to the side and just get the paint flowing out of the top. And I'm not doing a particularly good job aligning this. I've got the string tucked underneath the little circle tab here so that I don't get that all gummed up with paint. And I'm actually going to go right over that circular piece that the string goes around. Again, just dabbing straight through the stencil, occasionally coming off to the craft sheet to make certain that the paint is flowing well. And it really is just that up and down motion. But think of all the cool things you can do. You can make borders on your journal pages. You can just layer some elements for texture and background design. I mean, again, as always, the sky really is the limit. It's just about saying to yourself, well, it's okay if this doesn't, at least for me anyway, it's okay if this isn't perfect. I'll just move on and try it again a different way, or try something different. Part of the joy of experimenting is making mistakes and figuring out what does and doesn't work, but then there's also that serendipitous component, much in the way that I discovered using the iridescent medium over the top of the designs that I had done with the modeling paste, and it picked up that background color. To me, that was a wonderful mistake, if you will, because obviously the background color moved, but it picked up enough and it kind of colored the gel medium and gave me that really cool look. All right, well, you kind of get the effect of what's going on here. But again, paint and stencils, a perfect match. As we finish up today, I want to come back full circle to more or less where we started, which was with the modeling paste on the chipboard book covers. These are going to be smaller covers. Obviously, I'm working with some 9x12 watercolor paper, which I've cut in half, and that gives me sheets that are 6x9, and that's what I've done with this cover, and this is the one that I worked on earlier. You can pretty much put as many pages in your book as you have a binding ring that will accommodate it. Now, this is an 1.5-inch binding ring, and I forget exactly how many pages I have here, but probably 15 or 20. And by the time I get through with the thickness of the chipboard cover and then a chipboard back cover as well, I'll probably be right in about the range. And all I'll do once I've finished this, and I obviously have to put the iridescent medium on the back, I'll come in with my super duper handy dandy We Are Memory Keepers 1/4-inch hole punch, and I'm going to put 3 holes in here, and I'll put matching holes in all of the sheets of watercolor paper. And the nice thing about this punch is that it will easily punch through this chipboard, and I can probably pick up 3, 4, 5 pages and punch them all at once, so it makes it a fairly quick process. And what I'll do is use a ruler, and I'll probably measure up, and I'm just going to use a number for now, I'll measure up 1 inch and make a mark. On this punch, I can set the depth that this will move to with this slide, and I'm going to push that all the way to its most shallow point. And then I will use my mark on here as a guide. I'll line that up with the edge of the jaw of the punch. Go ahead and punch. I'll do the same thing here, and then I'll find a spot in the middle that I can measure off and do that. And then because the pages are the same size as the cover, my measurements will be the same, and it's easy to calculate where those go. Once all that's done, and obviously I still have to make a back cover, but once all that's done, it's just a question of putting it together with the binding rings, and then I have a great journal that I can give as a gift. I can, you know, if I have a smaller version of this, assuming that I cut the paper down, then I can put it in a bag or a tote, or I can just keep it to use it as I sit in front of the TV at night. I like to letter and just sort of scribble and doodle and do all those kinds of fun things. I hope that you enjoy using our Joggle stencils. We've got what I think is a great variety of designs. There's lots of options in terms of the mediums that you use them with, ranging from gels to modeling paste to paint, and then there's of course glitter and all those other fun things. And most of all, I hope that you make art and have fun.